We're talking about coming to terms with Jesus. You have to come to terms with Jesus and who he is, as we've been learning. And you really have to make the connection in how you and Jesus are just alike. That's key. And we talked last week about oneness with Jesus. Remember that you were spirit created in the image and likeness of God, and your discipline is love, characterized by joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And with that objective, you have to understand the strategies that you have to put in place. And one is that you can no longer view people from a carnal nature, from a human perspective. That means when you see people, you're supposed to see God, because they're created in the image and likeness of God. And when you look at people that don't see God, that is evidence that they are still in bondage to the human nature, and they need to be set free, not reminded of how bad they are or how messed up they are. That's what we have to keep in mind, because we understand that no one is responsible for the condition in which they were born. You know, those issues that they struggle with. You know, whether it's immorality, impurity, greed, filthiness, silly talk, coarse jesting, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envy and drunkenness, homosexuality, kidnapping, lying, perjury, carousing, fornication, adultery, having feminine qualities untypical of man, homosexuality, stealing, coveting, drunkenness, reviling, swindling, and whatever else is contrary to sound teaching. We have to stop trying to hold people responsible for those conditions. Because that's mankind's biggest problem. When he recognizes that he has an issue, he tries to take ownership of it. As religious people have tried to make people take responsibility for the condition in which they're in by telling them, you shouldn't be doing that. You know that ain't right. Yeah, they do. But they come to understand that no matter how hard they try, they can't overcome it, because the mind starts to tell them, that's just the way God created you. He didn't create you that way. That was your fault. And because of that, man received the character of Satan, which requires us to stop identifying people outside of their true identity. You can no longer identify people by their conditions, by their circumstances. This allows us to start to look at people and start to recognize what spirits are really in control in their lives and in our lives also, as we see them and how they determine our behavior. Now this helps us determine what changes need to be made, because we are in this new kingdom now. And that means that there has to be changes made so that you can line up with being in that kingdom. And this is the thing you have to understand about being in this kingdom, which is one of the biggest problems with being a Christian. Because of the fall, man is programmed to justify why he does what he does. No matter this woman that you gave me, Eve the serpent. See, they were trying to explain to God that they had a good reason for doing what they do. We have to recognize that it doesn't matter how good the reason you have for why you do what you do. That's not our objective in life. It's to understand why people do what they do or why they don't what they do. Our objective in life, if you want to grow and change, there has to be a standard set in place first. A standard. This means everything is judged by the standard. Because we don't go into situations in life to explain why you do what you do. We want to know whether what you did is right or wrong according to the standard. That's all we're after. That's all we're after. And that's the thing that we have to keep in mind as children. And a lot of people go into situations trying to explain why something was done or was not done. You have to know what the standard is. Because we want to change our behavior or confirm our behavior to make sure we are operating the behavior of the kingdom, right? Scenario, young people, please hear this because I want your input in this, right? You're driving down the street in your car, right? And as you're driving down the street, you see a pedestrian walking your way. And the pedestrian is on the shoulder of the road. He's come almost, look at that white line on the outside. He's on that white line. He's almost in your lane. You blow your horn. He doesn't move. Or she doesn't move. A car is coming on the other way, facing you. And the person still won't get out on the road. So you, by the time you see that the person is not getting out the road, you swerve across the center line and you hit the oncoming car and you have a serious accident. Who's at fault for that accident? Why? I was trying to save the pedestrian's life. It doesn't matter. You would be better off hitting the pedestrian and staying in the right. Now, doesn't that sound cruel?
Yes.
I know truck drivers, driving trucks, have pulled up behind people that pulled over in front of them. And they knew that if they kept going, they would have ran over that vehicle and crushed and killed everyone in it. They chose to swerve across the line, hit oncoming traffic. Guess who got charged and whose life got destroyed? The truck driver. Under no circumstances, because what is the standard? If you cross that center line and you have an accident, you are in fault regardless of what you did. Was it not a good thing, a good thought to try to save a pedestrian's life? That's what Christianity is. A lot of times you have to make tough decisions that look like it's going to take someone's life, destroy them, or put them in a bad situation. But God will not support anything that gets outside of his standard, regardless of what's on the line. Let that soak in. Some people used to believe that they were in the right because they were trying to avoid killing somebody. The law says, if you cross the center line and you have an accident, you're going to get a ticket. Failure to make safe movement, crossing center lines, maybe vehiculars, homicides, failure to see safe movement or whatever, negligence. That sounds so unfair, doesn't it? But that's the standard. Now, if you try to judge that by opinion or good reason, then the person may be justified. Life is a standard. That's what Christianity is. You're going to have to make decisions that appears is going to cause yourself or someone else harm. That's what God's going to honor. You got to get that. I believe you do. See, because the enemy will tell you that was a good reason. You were trying to save lives. After all, the pedestrian could have gotten killed. We just had some property damage over here. You can buy another car, right? Yes, you can. Probably will. But you'll have a ticket to pay, too. That's the reality of Christianity. There's never the argument, was it a good reason or not? The argument is, what is the standard? Because you're in a new kingdom now. And you have to judge your behavior based on the standards of the kingdom. God put one man in charge, not woman. And to most people, she was the best of both choices, right? Even though the other choice would have given everything you stood for too, right? So what are the options? It just happened to be the time of the church to come into this maturity and realize that God has been working to move it out from under the government as a means of taking care of it. And moving it into its place to realize that it is the supreme government who rules the world government. And as goes the government of the church, So goes the government of the world. It's a religion that has caused the world to be as hateful and as corrupt as it is, because it's hateful and corrupt. So we have chosen to no longer do that. We have chosen to follow God's way when we come into the kingdom of God. We stop identifying people outside of their true identity, which is spirit. Young people, please hear that. There is no good reason to disobey. Teacher tells you to be quiet in school, and one of your classmates is talking, and you tell the classmate, the teacher said, be quiet. You are wrong, and you will get caught. And you will come home saying, I didn't do nothing. I was telling my friend to be quiet because the teacher told us to be quiet. She didn't tell you to tell anyone to be quiet. There's a standard that she put in place that she expects you to follow. That's how we keep order. You don't have to like it. Just stay in her good blessings or his good blessings because they grade the test. But they decide what kind of grades you get. And some just may be immature enough to hold it against you. Are you with me? And they'll start the mission of making sure you dot every I and cross every T. Because you didn't do it right. And God said we ought to carry ourselves in a way that we can see good report of man and of God. But God has to be the first priority. In verse 18b, we are told that Jesus is the beginning of the firstborn from the dead. So he is the firstborn from the dead, open the way for anyone else that would choose to be born again and come from the dead. And we understand that when you were born in this world, you were born how? Dead. What does that mean? You were born separated from God with no hope of ever getting right with God. So those of you and those of you that have friends that say they want to give their life to God and they want to get it right first, tell them they don't have the power to do so. That's another one of Satan's deceptions. I got to get this right first, then I'll turn to God. You don't have the permission nor the authority to do that. You weren't born in some middle ground where you get to choose one or the other. You were born a slave to Satan and sin. And although we were born into that death, we have an opportunity now to get it right. You got the principle. Jesus is the first to conquer death. Alright, and we're in Colossians chapter 1. Sorry, verse 18. He is also head of the body, the church. And he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. So that he himself will come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven. Verse 18, we were told that Jesus is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. One of humanity's greatest fears is death. It is through this fear Satan has great control over humanity. It seems to be the persuasion that will work on you by the enemy when all else has failed. And Jesus came to conquer death because death is the thing. Even we talk about witnessing for God. We talk about going to witness to people that we don't need the word of God. There's a challenge sometimes when you are compelled or people try to encourage you to go in certain neighborhoods where death or bodily harm could be the results, right? That's the enemy's known one too. Sometimes he can't make you turn away from God, but he can make you become ineffective for God and put you in a position where you can't operate in the fullness of being a child of God because of some fear. See, when there's a fear, you start to panic and you start to try to make your own decisions and you can't hear God. And you really don't want to hear God because you know he's going to keep telling you to do the very thing that you're struggling with doing, right? And so this is the thing that Jesus conquered through his death, burial, and resurrection. He conquered death. Because that was one of man's drawbacks, and sin required a death. And he paid that death note because he was the perfect sacrifice, able to do so. And so through that, he rose from the dead, conquering death, the first one. So that now that he is the first one from the dead, to never to die again. And you keep in mind now, there were others that were resurrected from the dead. We think about Lazarus. But Lazarus eventually died again, right? Now, because of this, we don't longer have to fear death. That's the point that we have to understand why Jesus died. Because you have authority over death. And you have the authority to operate in your kingdom authority if you are willing to make those decisions that needs to be made to stay in spiritual authority. So that you can command the spirits that are at work in your circle to leave, which allows the kingdom to be set up, and it becomes the influencing power in your circle. And we have to understand that because our battle is not against flesh and blood. Keep in mind that this won't keep you from dying, because everybody has to die unless Jesus returns before you die. But when that time comes, you shouldn't be afraid of dying, because you understand where you're going. And once you get all these things settled, death won't be something you'll be afraid of, because you recognize there's no condemnation. That's why we're really understanding that God doesn't hold people's sins against them, because the enemy will have you focusing on things that you do that don't line up with God's word. You know, God has promised to deliver you and bring you into deliverance from that thing if that's what you believe, if that's what you desire. This brings us to this principle which says Jesus is the first to conquer death. Look at Romans 6, 9 through 14. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again, death is no longer master over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. We're talking about coming into the kingdom of God, coming into terms with Jesus, and really understanding. This truth is the foundation of your knowledge of your new life in Christ. This new life, the decisions that we have to make to change the attitudes and behaviors that we were born in is founded on this truth right here. You have to understand that the death that Jesus died, he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. So now that Jesus rose from the dead, right, the life that he lives now, he lives to God. We understand that, right? Sin no longer has control over him. This is foundational to you being and walking to the authority and power that God has given you to enjoy the full benefit of being children of God. Young people, understand this. You got to understand this, because one of the challenges with turning your life over to the Lord, you know that you have desires inside that don't line up with the Word of God. And there is a fear that if you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, these behaviors are going to become part of your life, and you know it doesn't please God, and you don't want to put yourself in a position where you don't please God, because you understand and know the consequences behind that, right? This is why this truth here is so important. When Jesus rose from the dead, that life that he's been living since then, he now lives that life to glorify God in obedience to God. And nothing will ever change that truth. You got to get that. See, because this helps you not try to take ownership for your deliverance, for your growth, for your healing. So that you can focus on what you need to be focused on in this equation. Your will. What is your will? What is your desire now that you are a child of God? That's what you have to keep clear at all times. And you have to be honest. Because the honesty will let you know where you really are in your growth process, not something to be ashamed of, like the enemy will try to make you be. Don't be fake and act like you don't have these feelings that you have. Whether it be toward a boy or a girl or whatever, or a desire for this, don't do that. That's what the enemy wants you to do. When people speak to you about it because they see it, don't deny it. Just say, yes, I'm guilty. What can I do? That's the fight. Just like before you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the church and religious folks tried to make you take responsibility for the condition that you were in, both lying, cheating, stealing, whatever. And it was a miserable time, wasn't it? Wasn't it miserable? You knew you wanted to stop. You already knew you were jacked up. And every time you turn around, somebody tells you how jacked up you are, right? And that becomes the challenge. And then you become defensive.
Then you become resentful. Then you become bitter because now you even try harder to change and you still fail because no one showed you how to be set free. That's why we as adults, we don't be concerned. When we go out today and we ride down somebody and say something, the first thing is, I'm going to smack the color off you. You're like, yeah. You don't say, I didn't mean that. Yes, you did. Yes, you did. Talk to God about it. Yes, God, you know right now? That's a true feeling. And right now, if you wouldn't move and they continue to press me, there's a strong possibility I'm going to try to carry that out. That's not taking ownership. That's being honest. He said, thank you, son. That's all I needed to know. I want to see what you act like you're all righteous. And said, oh, thank you, Jesus, because I dislike the color of the law. Say something. You might be glad I love Jesus. When you even have those conversations, let you know you are a victim already.
Yep, that's it. That's it.
Because all they got to do is press you just a that's little it. Bit more. Yep.
That's it.
Sometimes all they got to do is get a little closer.
Yep, that's it.
Young people, understand this. That's your fallen nature.
Yeah.
It will be with you until you leave here. The Bible has told you it will not submit to God. It will not obey God. That's why you have to understand this truth about Jesus' resurrection, because that's the foundation to free you from that truth. Because you aren't proving you don't have power over it. Hiding don't give you power over it. Acting like you didn't hear it or see it don't give you power over it. It just delays the inevitable. So this is foundational. You've got to get that. How do I walk in this victory? How can I walk into this newness of life? Over in Romans chapter 6. And even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Alive to God how? In Christ Jesus, right? What did we just learn about the life that Jesus is living now that he's been raised from the dead? How's he living that life? To God, right? Mm-hmm. Now, what did he say? But you yourselves consider yourself dead to sin, but alive to God. Where? In Christ Jesus. That's the foundation. That's your key. If you want to live the life that God wants you to live. Consider yourself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Because if I'm in Christ Jesus, what's going on? Jesus is living his life to glorify God. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present your members as instruments of righteousness to God. What does that look like? You just roll on a person and you realize that in this place your human nature has more control and you have a desire to slap the taste out of their mouth. Right? God said, look, it's time. Now let's take that and give it as an offering to God. This place of your mind right here that wants to slap the taste out of the person's mouth, ask for the power to pray for them. You know how you teach the children what they do with their hands? You know, you teach the children of what words they're supposed to say? Now is your time to live up to what you teach. Oh God, I thank you for showing me this. Lord, I take this attitude and I bring it to you because this is not the attitude of the kingdom. I should never want to slap the taste out of anybody's mouth. I didn't give them taste anyway. Forgive me, God. Say, God, rebuke you in the throne of Christ. You attitude of anger and violence, I present you to God as a living sacrifice today. Holy Spirit, move into this place in my mind and give me the attitude that I would want to go hug them and show them the unconditional love of God. That I would speak blessings upon them. That I have an attitude of gentleness and peace and unconditional love in this place. Guess what? It has to happen. Why? Because where does Christ live now? In you. You've just shown your will. Your will is to submit to God. Whatever you ask according to the will of God, He will do. You say, I already tried and failed. He said, that's why we're doing this, because you're now giving the Holy Spirit permission to take you there and make it so. That's why that truth is so fundamental. You have to understand this, because He said, present your members. Take those hands that want to do violence. Present them to God. Take that mind that wants to think violence. Take it to God. Take those feet that want to walk to violence. Present them to God. Take that energy that want to manifest violence. Present it to God. That's the process. Not denying that you have it or giving a good reason why you did it, because the behavior does not line up with the standard. That's what makes it wrong. It's the standard. You've been empowered to overcome it. That's why Jesus is inside of you. Because it has been proven that the flesh was too weak to carry it out. Now we've been positioned to carry out the righteousness of God in our own life. But look how easy that is if you really understand the process. Now think about that for a second. Does that not take deliverance or what? On your best day, do you think you had a power on your own to not at least want to say, you shouldn't have done that? Then you would say, God don't know what He's doing. God didn't know what He's doing when Trump became president, when He said He puts everybody in leadership job that he was on vacation. Was that Michael was on the job that day and he didn't know what to do, so he got in? Or was it Gabriel? Or some of the angels? God had to be gone, because there's no way God would do that, right? That's because you think you're good. You think you don't deserve somebody like that. But you forget, God uses everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. He uses everything. His thoughts are not our thoughts. That's why we have to understand this foundation. Is Jesus is now living a life to God. And He is now living His life through you. How is this possible? Galatians 2, 20 and 21. My old self has been crucified with Christ. Here it is. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Chew on that a second. Understand the concept of the foundation of your new life in this new kingdom. It ain't about you. It's Christ living His life through you. You just got to know what the standard is so you can look at your behavior and ask the right questions. So you ask the right questions so there'll be no distraction. Mm-hmm. Well, what's the standard? What did the head say when it was presented? That's all that matters. Mm-hmm. That's all that matters. If we say we follow the head, right? Mm-hmm. The head is spoken. That means you're supposed to go on to the next topic, right? It makes the learning curve short, sweet, and quick. Like Sarah did. Now, y'all, Sarah's a woman just like y'all. Y'all understand that, right? She wasn't no super saint that had wings and a halo around her head. She was an everyday lady just like you. Well, nothing special about it. Her husband said, look, we don't act like we brothers and sisters, because they're going to want to come in and lay with you and do all sorts of things, and we need to let them know that's okay. So they don't want to kill me just in case they think I might want to have some problem with that. We're going to let them know up front by my behavior that I have no problem with this. I'm going to be your brother while you're in Egypt. See, if you ain't right, you say you're going to be my brother now? You're going to be my brother when you think you can get away and we can get away. You're going to be my brother then too? Matter of fact, you probably gonna be my brother from now on. Don't be lying, come on, be real. You don't even want to jump and look at that old girlfriend or something you used to have. You gonna talk about what you gonna pimp me out? What you gonna be doing now that I'm your sister? This is real life, y'all. The Bible is real life. I don't know how what you see when you read it, but it's just real life. Just imagine yourself being in that position. See, I wouldn't even whip. Well, look, I know God ain't told me to go to Egypt. If you got to be my sister, no, God ain't told me to go to Egypt. I'm going to take my chances somewhere else. Because look, ain't nothing like a... going to life rough enough. Well, you got to go alone, and ain't no joy in life. Nah, I know he told me to go that way. Whatever joy I got in my life, I got to keep. And if going to Egypt means I got to give up a little bit of that, that ain't, nah, I know God ain't told me to go there. See, that's the way I'm going to hope you respond. I'm just saying, look, you got to know you. You got to know what works for you and what doesn't. You got to know that what the standard says so you can put yourself in the best position to follow it. At least take you build yourself up to see the awesomeness of God or how and what he'll do to you when you practice that thing for a while. It'll change your whole way of thinking. It'll position you in some power that you didn't know you had. And once you start, oh, okay, yeah, I'm glad I didn't have to go to Egypt with my wife to find this out. And so that's why I diligently search the scriptures in the most simplistic way to get the result that God says, which is righteous. So what is the standard? I'd rather measure myself against the standards on a sunny day when the weather's fine, life is good, than to not pay attention and get in the storm and got to do this. And it's just too much. If you've ever been there, you know what I'm talking about. You're trying to survive. You're trying to stay right with God. You're trying to keep everybody happy where they need to be in your circle. That's a lot of everyday's pressure, and I'm telling you, how strong you are, it will bring you to a place like, what's my name today? But you just don't, you ain't sure about nothing. And life becomes worse. It's already bad, but now it's worse. You're going to survive, you know this. But this journey, Lord, I just got to, look, just take me to the mountain. I can't make it to the mountain, but I need to go. Take me. We need to talk, but I can't find words, Lord. Just speak through me, please. Say something. Just get it. I just need it, Lord. See, those are not places that I like going. And I found out that if I ever find myself there, I need to be at full capacity so that I can think clearly, be assured, and remember my name. So that when I come through this thing, it's like, yes, it's working. I can see the work. I can see some results. It's changing. Because I learned how to look at the simplest places for victory. The simplest places. I don't be looking for change, just some slight sign that my daddy is here at this place. No, I mean, I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. But there are places with God where it's just hard to believe God exists. And this is why it's important to understand this, because when you get into this place, it frees the Lord to live through you, to strengthen you, to give you wisdom, to protect your heart and your mind from all that's trying to come in. And you will have the assurance to know that it's real. How is this possible? Like I said, my old self has been crucified with Christ, and it's no longer I that lives, but Christ lives in me. How can I share in this victory over death? Those who have been born into God's family do not make a practice of sinning because God's life is in them. So they can't keep on sinning because they are children of God. So now we can tell who are children of God and who are children of the devil. Anyone who does not live righteously and does not love other believers does not belong to God. 1 John 3, 9 through 10. That's newness of life, the power to live, verse 19.
We're talking about coming into this new kingdom, Jesus being the first one raised from the dead. We have to understand the significance of that and make the connection between ourselves and Jesus so we can have what we need and know how to access what we have so that Jesus can live through us. Does anybody here believe that Jesus struggles with being himself?
No.
Right? He can be himself regardless, all right? Does anyone that thinks that Jesus is less than who he is because he lives inside of you? No one, right? Now, don't you think that's a good place to be if he can always be himself and live his life through you? This is where the connection is. When you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you come into oneness with Christ as he comes to dwell inside of you. You become born again, and God gives you a new heart and a new mind and puts the Holy Spirit inside you. Transitioning from a worldly way of thinking into a spiritual way of thinking and doing things is extremely difficult. This is true because the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the spirit wants. And the spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature wants. These two forces are constantly fighting each other so that you are not free to do what you want to do or to carry out your good intentions. That's why you must understand your connection between Jesus and yourself and that life that he now lives through to God. That's your connection. This takes away all excuses for not following Christ. And it takes the burden away from you trying to take responsibility and ownership for the condition you find your human nature in. It's always been that way. You don't have to take responsibility for moving into the righteousness of God. You allow Jesus to live his life through you. You just make sure you position your heart and your mind to want the will of God. You know, is it always your will to want to do what pleases God? Is it your will to want to do what's right toward others? That's the proof that God is working in you, because he said you can't have that if he's not working in you to do it. And that's the proof, and we have to know how to recognize this proof. Although you were born again and free from Satan's power, the mind is still programmed to Satan's character. Therefore, it is still corrupted and subject to vanity and alienated from the life of God. To combat this corruption, you must gain control over your mind. And this is what we're talking about now. This is how you gain control over your mind by knowing what the standard is, looking at your behavior and your desires to see whether they line up with that standard. This is extremely important now that the church has stepped into its place of authority and is now ruling the world and the things in the world. You are held accountable for what you know. And the enemy, although he can't unborn you, he can put you in a position where you live a very unproductive life that does not line up with being children of God. Your mind was given to you to be programmed in the principles and truths that must be practiced to develop the attitudes, habits, beliefs, and ideas to carry out God's plan for your life. You got to take it personally for your own life. Saints, as we are moving into our relationship with God, you have to forget all the hype and stuff that you've learned about church, that the world is still trying to promote as church. To move away from wanting to be entertained, this is a place of learning, of growing, coming to an understanding of who you are and how to walk in that understanding. This is what church was established for, not the thing that's presented as church. It's not an entertainment center. It's not a place where you come to feel good. It's a place where you come to grow in the knowledge and understanding of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ so you can live the life that you want to live and the one that you go out working and pursuing every day. It is the pursuit of righteousness through which every blessing has been promised. And that picture, when you go out there, when people talk about how much fun they had in church, how the spirit was high, and how they just praised and worshiped your Lord, you observe them and see how they live it.
See what kind of power they have, that their lives line up with the character of God and the standard that you know doesn't change regardless of where you go to church at. Not how they do it or how we do it. This is about you taking control of your life. How many want to have control of their life? I guess that's the next thing. How many of you want to have control of your life so you are not being controlled by those things outside of you? Only the adults. Okay. Only the adults want to take control. We got one child over there. So I guess the rest of you young people, you don't want to have control of your life. Now that makes sense. I understand things better now. Makes sense. Okay. In verse 19, we're told that it was God's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in Jesus. Pay attention. What does he mean by fullness and what is this fullness? This brings us to this next principle. Jesus is the church's source for righteous living. Jesus is the source for righteous living. God said, look, he put everything in Jesus. Everything you need is where? In Jesus. Where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? So that's as far as I gotta go. Wait a minute, say that again. The life that Jesus now lives, he lives to God. And Jesus lives where? Beside of us. And everything that you ever need is where? Trying to tell me I don't have to go off nowhere to discover life and the fullness of life and enjoy all that God created me to have. It's in me. Like, I don't have to go nowhere but right here. Can y'all grasp that, young people? When the world has you saying you got to go out to France and Italy and all over the world to discover the goodness of the world. And I got to go to college and get this and get that. Let's get one thing clear. If you believe going to college is going to get you anything, you're going for the wrong reason. You understand that? Going to college teaches you how to work. Teaches you how to maybe learn and think on some process, some level, and some principle. It does not guarantee you a job. Does not guarantee you financial success. Does not guarantee you be famous. Does not guarantee anyone will ever recognize you. Everybody understand that, right? The things that you want are inside of you. Now, who could believe such a thing like that when you have been told you're so insignificant, right? It's all in you. That's the reality that we have to come to understand and believe. Jesus is the source of the church's. Jesus is the church's source for righteous living, and this righteous living is the fullness. 2 Peter 1, 3-4. By his divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know him, the one who called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. And because of his glory and excellence that lives where?
In us.
He has given us great and precious promises. These are the promises that enable you to share his divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. Young people, did you grasp that? God's divine power, that power that he used to raise Jesus from the dead, is now living inside of you if you are a child of God. He says, in this power that the promises of God are placed. And it's in this power, he has empowered you to become partakers, to become the divine nature, the nature of God, to be regenerated, who God created you to be. And it says that these promises enable you to share this, to escape the corruption of your human nature, where you no longer have to take ownership of it or responsibility for walking in it. It's a merely surrendering your will to God, trusting that he will lead you into this place that you want to go. You adults that talk about kingdom authority, that you want to be able to change your environment as you evaluate the wall, you evaluate the circumstances and situations that are going on around you, as you recognize the spirits at work, as you have confidence with God about what you see. And you talk to God about how it's influencing the environment. When you talk to God based on the things that He has taught you, if we could move that influencing spirit out of the way and allow the influencing spirit of the kingdom that counters that to influence the behavior of the people in this circle, that could change things for the people. That would free those that have a desire to do right, to do the right thing. It would move out those spirits that fight against people when they want to do things that are right, that are just. And this would be good for the kingdom as you have left us here, that your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. God, that lines up exactly what you taught me. Now, if there's any that I haven't learned, make that clear too. But based on what you taught me and what you allowed me to see, as I evaluate the wall, this is what needs to take place. Now, Lord, I ask that you will dispatch the heavenly host. Allow Michael, my prince, and the heavenly host to move into this environment and stand guard and prevent any spirits that will try to come in and have a negative influence based on establishing the kingdom. For this is what we do, God. This is what you said you want. I see driving that spirit out, Lord God, will make a way for righteousness, will make a way for justice, will make a way for equality for all. Lord, as I see those angry religious spirits at work that are propagating hate, Lord, it would be an awesome thing if the spirit of unconditional love would move in that place. Through strong conviction that they would recognize that they're not operating in unconditional love. That they'll be convicted, Lord. Send forth the angelic host to make it so. See, that's what we do. You gotta believe that that works. Because your battle is not against flesh and blood. I don't have a new body yet that I can just take my way to wherever I need to be, because God wants you to know you don't need to be everywhere. You have to understand authority and how it works. That's what the centurion told Jesus, right? He said, Lord, I got a child at home that's on the deathbed. Jesus said, look, I'm going to come with you and go with you home. He said, no. My home is not worthy for you to enter. But see, I'm a man of authority too. I have people under me. I tell this one to go this place, that one to go that place, and they do so. He said, you can do the same thing. You would just speak the word, and my child be healed. Jesus said, Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. I ain't seen that kind of faith among the children of God yet. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. He said, son, as you have spoken it, it is done. When the man got home, he said, look, what time did the child get healed? When he told him what time the child got healed, he said, Lord, that God, Jesus is the one. Because I know what time he told me. Let it be so. Do you believe? Lord have mercy. Why do you think he showed you that? You can't be in every place all the time. But he that's in me is in everybody that's born again and not born again. Because we recognize everybody is spirit created in the image of God, waiting to be woke up. Lord have mercy. Waiting to get a charge from the Holy Spirit. As he said, look, your angels have been working on your behalf. Wake up. Time to take over this mind and this body. And you can now start being who you want to be. You no longer have to sit back and watch and discuss as your mind and your human nature got you doing things you know you don't want to do. Got you crying about, feeling sad about, got you apologizing, got you drinking, got you getting high. Got you chasing women, chasing money, because you're trying to get it off your mind. There's hope, there's help, and it's here. He's called Jesus. And we come to set you free today. They don't know all of a sudden why they calling on God. Well, they ain't have time to think about God. Well, they was talking about all these fanatical Christians walking around talking about God. They were sick of them. Same ones now calling on God because they got their Saul now, they think. Saul is on the scene and he ain't taking us with us. He done made an edict that what he gonna do when he get in charge. Some folks actually will start trying to flee the camera already. Ain't nothing happened yet. They trying to get ahead of the game. Because they know Saul is a fire-breathing dragon and he ain't coming to make nobody feel good. That's how it's always been. You can't get God's folks to move when the sun is shining. They want to hang around because things look good. But oh, when Saul show up, Lord have mercy, everybody on the run. Everybody calling on God. Everybody calling on God. Everybody calling on God. Every single soul calling on God right now. I don't care what their, okay, what their title is, they calling on God. See, the rooster has come home to roost. We've been trying to tell you this for 200 years. But come to your house, man. He ain't sparing nobody, is he? See, at least we've been trained in it. We know how to survive under it. We ain't worried at all. We're trying to figure out what y'all so upset about. Ain't that right?
All right, Dad.
But my God has power, and he's the source. And in times like this, to let you, ain't nobody call Allah, Buddha. Everybody talking, oh my God.
Yes.
Oh God.
Yes.
Help us. Praying to God.
Yes.
Y'all said, I'm asking prayer. What y'all talking about? I got it. Do you believe you had the power to run things for God? Which is what he left you here to do.
Amen.
Don't nobody think you qualified for such a task, right? But it's amazing, they kind of understand you a little better now, don't they?
Yeah, boy, I tell you.
It make a little more sense to them now, don't
they? You don't look crazy to them,
I told one of my friends the other day that God never put woman in charge, and that because of the fall, the woman's going to be always trying to control the man. He said, you know, Curtis, that makes sense right there. Because me and my son, we just moving further apart. I said, what's going on? He had a wife of mine. I've been trying to help the boy get his life together, and every time he come around, I got him all but that she come in and give him some kind of trick.
Yep.
He said, now look at me. I got over 100 acres worth of land here. I've been totally successful all my life. People all over coming to me looking for advice. And I can't get them children to follow my one instruction I give them.
Yeah.
Yeah. It ain't like it's a secret. Look, Curtis, can you see that land right there?
Yeah.
How long you been knowing me? 30-some years. I know you as a respectful, sharp businessman and know how to make it. And you've lived this life and proved it. You say, I can't get them to believe. Nothing. Tell them. I said, yeah. And I read the Bible, then the truth came out. But I don't read it like I'm supposed to. Got some thoughts on your mind, don't you? You need to get in that book. Because God didn't put woman to be running the world. I said, because you know, the minute that she gets in that presidency of the free world, Satan's earthly kingdom will come to its fullness. And I don't know what happens at that point. Well, one thing I know, it's been thwarted this time. It didn't make it. See, it makes sense to me now when I was walking around that loop 8-10 years ago, hollering at the top of my voice, I rule the East Coast. Lord, can I rule the whole world? I ain't quite got that clear yet, but I do rule the East Coast. But Lord said, no, you rule the whole world. And up to now, 2016, 8 years late, Satan getting ready to make his move to crown his king. My God, but not this time. Church got it. Church got it. They stepped into their role as ruler. They ain't sleep. They called you. They trumped you. They trumped you. Can't go now. He done called it. He done called it. He done called it in my name. According to my will, he didn't get distracted on the evil. He stayed focused on the righteous. Now, I don't know who else was with me, but he didn't tell me it took a lot. He said, I looked for a man. It doesn't matter what anyone says. It doesn't matter what anyone thinks. I didn't jump on the bandwagon. Teams start winning. They jump on the bandwagon. That becomes their team. I was on this team when it looked like it didn't exist. And it looked like it should have been the same stuff. And when I see the things smoking, coming to pass in such a mighty way, and everything that was asked, said was needed, is now happening. I'm talking about everybody calling on God now. TV, the lesbian community, the liberal community, the Democratic community, the Republican community, the nations around the world, all of them calling on God. It looks bleak now, guys, because the Trumpster is here. If you have made it very clear. But the Trumpster didn't know he was created in the image and likeness of God. His language has changed. That's the power that we have. That's what we're talking about. This is what you have to come to terms with, young people. Ain't left naked. Look at Henderson and Oxford. Raleigh, every now and then. Lewisburg. On business. Pick up something. But the whole world is calling on. They're calling on God to get you to Jesus. Because no one comes to Jesus until they first talk by God. Therefore, everything you need is inside you through the Holy Spirit. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Ephesians 1:19. By this, love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment, because as he is, Jesus, so also are we in this world. Because you have been seated in heaven with Jesus. So the question is, do you have enough faith to believe this? Do you have enough faith to believe what's been shared with you this morning? At such an insignificant place as this, compared to what the world has told you is significant. See, you control the world. You control everything in it. But do you believe that? That your battle is not against flesh and blood. Principalities and powers. That's how you change things. And people will never know you work. They just come in one day with a different language. They're saying different things that you thought you would never hear said. You see behavior that you never thought you would see, and you're like, wow, I didn't have to say nothing. Because all you have to do is pay attention. See, it's the little things where you see God working at that sometimes we overlook. That's why you got to always listen to see how God is working in your midst. And know what you've talked to God about. And when you start seeing God produce what you say you asked for, just say, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Don't walk up to God and say, Lord, I've been praying for you. I've been wondering when you're going to change. Don't, just don't do that. Don't mess it up. Just don't mess it up. Just enjoy it. Observe it. Isn't it awesome? Don't matter how bad the beast looks. God created everything. And he has power over everything. Do you have the faith to believe this? In verse 20, we are told that God's plan is to reconcile all things to himself through Jesus. In Adam's disobedience, humanity was separated from God with no hope of restoring his relationship with God. This is what we're talking about, young people. You were born without a relationship with God, regardless of what the world has told you. You were born an enemy with God. And you know that by your rebellion against authority in your life. By yourself and this self-centeredness. This rendered him incapable of choosing or doing that which is acceptable to God. Which brings us to this next principle. Jesus made peace between God and mankind. Because we're trying to come to terms with Jesus. God has made peace with all mankind.
But now in Christ Jesus, you who formerly were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made both groups into one, and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall by abolishing in his flesh the enmity, which is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so that in himself he might make the two and two one, new man, thus establishing peace, and might reconcile them both in one body to God through the cross, by it having put to death the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. But through him, we both have our access in one spirit to the Father. You hear that? Through Jesus Christ, we all have access to the Father. Everything we need is in Christ. And all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to himself. That's what we read each week. You have the ministry of reconciliation. Through relationship, you're supposed to be leading people back to God. Not by trying to preach to them verses, but by living in the unconditional love, living according to the standard that you have set that represents God in the decisions that you make. That is the power in your circles of influence. Not trying to lower your standards and be friends with people. Because in this chaotic world, your friends are going to need to know some truth at some point in time, and they're going to need some stability. They're going to need some kind of security to know and believe that they can get better. And when you lower your standards, you remove yourself from that position. But even though people might talk about you, the reason they talk about you is because you remind them of their fallenness and their weaknesses. But when things get tough, they're going to admire you. They're going to seek you out for counsel. They're going to seek you out for help. If nothing more, to somebody to show them some love. Somebody that's not going to judge them. Somebody that's going to be there to help support them. Even after they have turned their back on you, talked trash about you, but when they find out their world is not all they thought it was, and everybody in it is not all who they pretended to be, they're going to realize that you've always been the same. That loving, unjudging, caring person that has always told them the truth and looked out for what was good for them. And a lot of times that means the thing that turns people around after they ran their gamut and found out that it doesn't do all that they thought it was going to do. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making this appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead. Come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ, or we may enjoy the righteousness of God. That's what I'm talking about, young people. You have to recognize that you don't have to take the ownership for your righteous standing when you give your life to the Lord. God is working through Jesus Christ to make sure you obtain that level of righteousness that he's called you to live in. He's put Jesus inside of you and the Holy Spirit inside of you to make sure that you do so. Just stop pretending. Be honest with yourself, because God already knows. And if any born-again believers around you, they know regardless of what you're telling them. Because we understand what the standards are. We understand what it's supposed to look like. And we don't expect you to get there overnight as we are growing. We realize that it's a process. We understand the thing that is key is what is your will. And those of you that are constantly going through, well, Lord, did I sin? Was that wrong? What am I doing? What do I do? The question is, what was your will? Well, I wanted to do what God wanted me to do. That's why I'm having this conversation, because I'm concerned on whether I did or not. That lets me know that God is leading you, so I'm happy. You can't want to do God's will if God is not inside of you making it so. You can't carry it out unless God carries it out. You just start to have to recognize that it's a journey and be truthful for where you are at any given moment and ask yourself, do I want to change? Right here, do I really want to be like God? Not, it's impossible. It's hard. It's difficult. When the smoke is clear, deep in your heart and your spirit, what is your objective? is it to please God and glorify God. Even in your desire not to choose God, is a desire that when you choose Him, you want to please Him? That lets you know that God is working on you. You can't have that kind of concern for God and obeying God if God is not working in you. Just the desire that I am not going to make the decision now because I know I got issues and I ain't going to go in there trying to serve God with these issues. Please come. That's all He needs right there. That's your guarantee that you will be delivered. You don't have a clue how it's going to work. That's what God works through. Your will and His will must be the same. Your desire for righteousness must be the desire that you're walking in. Not whether I can do it, or am I doing it, or how much it's going to take to do it. Just know that that's all the Lord needs to do His part. He understands the weakness of the human nature. He understands the lack of practice for the inner man, the practice taking control. He understands and knows all that. It's will. You've been given free will. And that free will, if your will is to serve God and glorify God, God is pleased. Because you can't do that through the human nature. Human nature has no desire to please God. I don't know where it finds you at. I hope it finds you really thinking about what we said. I hope it finds you reflecting on the things that have been shared here since you've been here. Things that we prayed about, things that we talked about. I hope in that reflecting, you're able to look at what's going on around you now and see, do they match up or have anything in common? So that you can decide whether you have total confidence in what you're being taught and enough faith in it to apply it, believing and knowing that it's going to bring about the change in your life that you truly desire, even though you can't understand it. That's what I'm hoping to take place today. You know, don't try to figure it out. That comes after faithfully walking in. That's when you'll see the results. But that faith, that will must be tested to see whether it's genuine or not. We're going to listen to some music. What you think about what I said? It's a good day to give your life to the Lord. Good day to